March 28th, 2024. I'm here on the last day of INB negotiations on a pandemic treaty. I'm here with the representative from DNDi. Can you start out by introducing yourself and telling people a little bit about you?
Yeah, sure. So my name is Ricardo Matute. I'm from Venezuela, and I have been living in Geneva for 7 years. I used to work on the mission of Chile to the UN, and with them I was almost 5-6 years. And for a long time I was in charge of the health agenda with them. And then recently I switched and I'm start a new position as a policy advocacy with DNDi. And I have been involved in the INB process for a long time for now.
How would you describe where we are right now after I think, 12 days of negotiations here?
Yeah, sure. I mean, it really depends on who do you ask. That you can feel a bit of a tense atmosphere in WHO. And I think since the beginning, we haven't had 100% clear modalities and process. And I think that's also carry on in the process. Some people also are optimistic. Some people are pessimistic. So I think it really depends on who you ask. I think it's a complicated process. WHO has 75 plus years, and they only have one instrument, which is the AFCTC. So it's not something that is common to do these kind of negotiations. It's really complex, really complicated, and we are trying to solve a big issue. So I think it's a surprise that it's not an easy and fluid process. And now we're in a place that I think member states need to take some hard decisions, maybe. I think we have a really good opportunity to have a tool that can do PPR better, like help us to prevent, to prepare, and to respond for a future pandemic. And I think we should not miss this opportunity. We as a collective, member state, non-state actors, civil society, government, WHO, etc. I think as a collective, as people that want something to not go through what we went on during COVID, I think we have a really good opportunity. I think we should not miss it. It's hard. There are red lines that member states have, and I think we need to help them, and member states need to work in a way to conciliate those gaps and to get together and get it done.
What are the areas that DNDi is focused on the most in this negotiation?
So for now, it's really important, everything that is related to research and development. DNDi has 20 years of experience in this field, and with the experience that we have and the end-to-end work that we've done, we have figured out that some stuff can be done different. And we think it's a great opportunity to reflect this stuff in the text. Some of those are conditionalities. If government have public funding for research and development to develop some health tools, we think it's a great moment to use that leverage to put some conditions in those research and development. And then you can ensure some access, some tech transfers, some licensing. It could be a list of different stuff, but the most important thing is that if you try to negotiate during a pandemic, you have everything to lose. During an emergency, you as a government don't have leverage, you have political pressure, it's in the middle of an emergency, so you have to resolve immediately some stuff. Instead, if you negotiate in peacetime and before a pandemic, it not only create a solid basis for everyone, and it helps to coherence and to everyone to understand and be in the same page, but also allows you to have more leverage to do so. So we think that's a great opportunity that you have to really operationalize equity even before an emergency happens, and then government have more space to work with it.
What has surprised you, if anything, in this session?
In this session, well, it didn't surprise me that we haven't finished, because again, it's complex. What it did surprise me is that we didn't advance as much as I was expecting. We didn't even yellow some text. Member states haven't go through the text several times. This is not the first iteration. It has been one, two, three, four, I think there's even five iterations of the text with different names. And even though I recognize, and I think most people recognize, there has been some progress, important progress even in some articles. For example, Article 9, we think there is progress there. Even though nothing is completely, not even yellow. So those agreements or consensus or compromises feel a bit, I don't know if the word is weak, but not solid enough yet, because we haven't get that part when member states say, okay, this part of the text, at least this part, is an agreed text. So I think I'm a bit surprised about that. At this point, I wish we were there, and we're not. But I'm also really hopeful to see a lot of informals happening, meaning that a lot of members, they are trying to build some bridges and try to solve the difference that in plenary has been not been able to solve.
Our look at Article 9 and Article 11, Article 11 being the one on technology mm-hmm. transfer, mm-hmm. and Article 9 being the one on R&D, it seemed, in agreement with what you said, it seemed like Article 9 was less divisive than Article 11.
Yeah.
So congratulations on your work on that.
Well, it's just because I think there is a recognition that that is a fact, that it's better to negotiate in peacetime and not during an emergency, and as a recognition of the leverage that government has during if they have public funding, if they put basically money to do that. I don't think the work is done. I think there is way more that we can work on that line. We would like to see mandatory conditions. We would like to see some stuff in, for example, clinical trials that we think that are still missing. We think it's just ethical and equity that if you do any clinical trial in a community, that community should have direct access to the end result of that research. So I think it's not that the work is done. It has progress, and I think it's one of the less contentious articles, which is good because it means that we could achieve something. But I think members, they need to be as ambitious as they can, and that's where we are. We are trying to be really ambitious on this because we think we could achieve something that could be the real representation of equity, at least in one of the parts of the instrument.
Thank you. Before I turn off the video, is there anything you'd like to add?
I think it's important to recognize that this is a complicated process, and member state delegates are tired, and you can also feel it after 10 days, 12 days this week, but it's not only this week. They also are doing the IHR, and there has been 2+ years of negotiations, and some of the delegates are frustrated, and it's understandable, and I think that I just express support for what they're doing, because I think this is going to keep going at least a bit more. So we need the energy to go through it, member state actors, delegate non-state actors, to keep pushing for good things for the instrument. But it's a recognition of that, the fact that it's not an easy process, and I do hope that the informals that we have seen in this week keep going. Not forget that that's happening, even if we're going to have we are not clear about the way forward, but if we're going to have a new text or something, I think it's important that the informals continue, members, they keep talking, and also to create a space where we, as the actors, civil society, and other entities can also have an honest and transparent conversation with them to try to, as a collective, solve the issues that we're trying to solve.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Great.